15-minute lecture series, Anatomy and Physiology, Chapter 1, Introduction to Human Anatomy and Physiology. So, back in the early days, we learned about human anatomy from treating wounds and injuries a person received by comparing human body to animals that were butchered up for food, and also studying human corpses. Anatomy actually means the process of cutting up. The official definitions of anatomy is the branch of science that deals with the structure of the body parts, while physiology is the branch of science that deals with the functions of body parts. Clearly, these two branches of science are closely intertwined. For instance, looking at the hand, if you look at the structures of the hand and how the muscles are attached to the bones of the fingers and the arrangement of the fingers and the thumb, it gives you a pretty clear idea that the function is to wrap around a structure of some form so that we can tell by the structure that the function of the hand is to grasp things, to hold it tightly wrapped around by the fingers and the thumb. Levels of organization. We are organized all the way down to the atomic level. One atom, the smallest. Atoms can be, when you get two or more atoms bound together, you get molecules. Molecules that are thousands or more atoms long are called macromolecules. There are organelles within cells that produce important functions. Cells come together to form tissues. Many, many cells make a tissue. Different tissues can come together to form an organ for an important function. Put the organs together, you get an organ system. Put all the organ systems together, you get an organism. Characteristics of life. Movement. Movement occurs both inside the body and the body moving around in its outside environment. Responsiveness, the ability of the body to respond to changes either inside or outside of the body. Growth, the ability of cells to get bigger or even the cells to divide, and this can lead to the organism getting bigger or there's reproduction where you get the division of cells into new cells and also potentially a production of a new organism. Respiration, breathing in and out air. Digestion, bringing in materials and breaking them down. This often means breaking them down into nutrients that can be absorbed, absorption into the body. These nutrients then can travel, be circulated throughout the body, circulation, and then arrive at cells where they'll be absorbed by the cells. And then there will be assimilation, chemical changes to the substance. So digestion obviously has done some chemical changes to what we brought into the body. You can also then take those nutrients and change them chemically again to build new things within the body. And excretion, getting rid of any wastes. Altogether, we have what's called metabolism, combined chemical reactions in cells that use or release energy. So basically, all the chemical reactions in your body make up your metabolism. Important things in life include water. We need water all the time. It is the most abundant chemical in the body. Many of our chemical reactions occur in the presence of water, and water is also a great transport medium, moving materials throughout the body, including heat. We can find aqueous solutions, aqueous meaning watery solutions, both inside the cells, intracellular, or outside of cells, extracellular. Sometimes this could be fluids around the cells themselves. Sometimes it's in other compartments, such as blood vessels. Then we'd have blood plasma, and so forth. We also need food. Food is needed to provide energy, break it down to make energy, or to be raw materials for growth and repair of our structures. Oxygen is needed to release energy from food. Heat is also important. We need our body to be at a set temperature because the metabolic reactions, the chemical reactions, work best at around our body temperature. And then there's also pressure. This could be for a gas or a liquid. Atmospheric pressures, the pressure in the air. We alter the atmospheric pressure in our lungs to allow us to breathe in and out. Hydrostatic pressures, the pressure of fluids on the surrounding structures. So this would be, for instance, blood pressure. And blood pressure is important because it helps the blood flow throughout the body. Homeostasis. Homeostasis is the maintenance of a stable internal environment. We have very specific sets of criteria for many, many, many different things, from body temperature to amount of water and bloodstream to various chemicals in the bloodstream that we need to regulate. To do this, we have receptors that monitor for changes. These receptors could be monitoring for changes that are internal or external to the body. Then the changes will be compared to the set point, what the normal or ideal range is for that value. And should it have varied too far from the set point, then effectors will be commanded to respond to those changes to try to return things to the set point. So negative feedback. Most of the time, we're talking about negative feedback. There's a change from the set point, and so we want to return it back to the set point. We want to reduce the amount of change that had occurred. So if there is too much of a change by the stimulus in one direction, we want to respond and return it to the set point. If there's too much of a change in another direction, we want to detect it, respond, and return it again to the set point. So if you are out ice fishing and your body temperature decreases too much, the receptors that will detect this change, they'll send that information to the brain where it'll compare it to the set point, to the 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit. If our body temperature is lowered too much, then it will send commands to the effectors, to the blood vessels to constrict so less heat is lost to the skin, to the skeletal muscles to shiver to try to generate more heat and return us back to the set point. Or on the opposite, you get way too hot, you're outside cutting wood, everybody does it. Your receptors will detect this increase in body temperature, send that information to the brain to compare it to the set point. It'll send commands to the effectors, to the blood vessels near the skin to dilate, to carry more heat to the surface of the body, to the sweat glands to release sweat that will evaporate, carry the heat even faster away from the body. And, of course, with the goal being to lower our body temperature and return us to that normal ideal range. There are a couple of positive feedback mechanisms that when they act, they respond by changing the conditions to further and further away from the set point. We'd be really bad at blood pressure, but it's really good for blood clotting. We want a clot to form quickly to keep us from bleeding out. And also very important for birth. The mother really at some point wants the baby to be expelled. Organization of the body. Well, to start off with, there are a number of cavities that hold soft structures. For instance, we have the cranial cavity that holds the brain and the vertebral canal that holds the spinal cord, collectively known as the dorsal chambers. Also found in the skull, besides the cranial cavity, are the orbits, the orbital cavities for the eyes, the nasal cavity, the oral cavity for the tongue and teeth, a middle ear cavity for hearing, some sinuses within some of our bones. Then we have the ventral chambers, which includes the superior thoracic cavity in the chest area, and the abdominal pelvic cavity below that. The thoracic cavity is separated from the abdominal pelvic cavity by the diaphragm, an actual physical separation. The abdominal pelvic cavity can be broken down into the abdominal cavity and the pelvic cavity. However, these cavities have no physical separation. If you take a closer look at the thoracic cavity, you see it's broken down into four smaller cavities. The right and left pleural cavities, which basically surround the right and left lungs, the pericardial cavity that basically surrounds the heart, and the mediastinum, which includes everything between the lungs. So that would also include the heart, as well as part of the trachea, part of the bronchi, aorta, etc. Now, what forms the pleural cavities and the pericardial cavities are serous membranes, specific serous membranes. A serous membrane is a two-layered structure with a cavity in between that is filled with some fluid. Imagine it is a water balloon with the organ pushed into there, with one layer lying on the organ and another layer exposed to what is outside and surrounding that organ. This arrangement, these serous membranes are very important because they reduce the friction that that organ experiences. So our heart is always moving. So it has the pericardium, the serous membrane that surrounds it. It has the visceral layer lying on the heart organ, the parietal layer that rubs against the sternum, the vertebral column, the lungs. Heart's constantly moving. It needs to be protected from the friction generated by that movement. Same for the lungs. They are within the pleural membranes with a visceral layer lying on the lung itself and a parietal layer protecting it from the rib cage, from the heart, and the other things it rubs against as the lungs expand and deflate. There's also another serous membrane in the abdominal cavity. This is called the peritoneum. It is a very large serous membrane. It surrounds some but not all of the organs in the peritoneum, in the abdominal cavity. Peritoneum has a visceral layer and a parietal layer with that thin cavity in between. And it not only reduces friction from all these internal organs that are moving around, but also can attach them to the abdominal walls. 11 body systems. Boom, skeletal system with bones, ligaments, joints. Its functions include protection of soft tissues, framework for the body, attachment for muscles, blood cell production, and storage of inorganic salts such as calcium. Molecular system, muscular system, muscles, joints, tendons, involved in movement, posture, body temperature. Nervous system with the brain, spinal cord, nerves, sense organs, important for receiving information, interpreting information, responding information. Pretty critical for homeostasis. The integumentary system, including the skin, subcutaneous layer, and associated structures for protection, for regulating body temperature, for housing sensory organs. Endocrine system, all the glands and part of the brain. It includes pituitary glands, thyroid glands, pancreas, thymus, ovaries, testes, adrenal glands, etc. All these glands produce hormones, and some of these hormones are involved in regulating our metabolism. Cardiovascular system, heart, blood vessels, and the blood. Important job of the heart pumping the blood through the vessels, transporting substances throughout the body. We've got the lymphatic system, also a series of vessels, lymph vessels, that pass by lymph nodes, the spleen, very important, tonsils, thymus, lymph fluid. It moves excess fluids back into the cardiovascular system, carries fatty substances into the bloodstream, and defends against infections. Then we have the digestive system, mouth, esophagus, stomach, large intestine, small intestine, etc., etc., involved in breaking down food, both physically and chemically, so that it can be absorbed, absorbs those particles, and eliminates anything that is undigested. Respiratory system, nasal cavity, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi, lungs, moving air in and out and allowing for gas exchange with the bloodstream. Urinary system, kidneys, ureters, urinary bladder, urethra, removes waste from the blood, helps maintain the proper composition of the blood, stores urine and eliminates urine. Reproductive systems, the male reproductive system, testes, scrotum, penis, involved in producing sperm and getting rid of it. And the female system, ovaries, uterine tubes, uterus, vagina, involved in producing oocytes, receiving sperm, and providing an environment for the embryo and fetus to develop. And anatomical position is the position that you think of a person in, or when you're talking about organ structures within them, the person's facing forward, palms anteriorly, palms facing forward. Have some directional terms for comparing two things, anterior toward the front of the body, posterior toward the back of the body, so the belly button is anterior to the small of the back. Superior and inferior toward the head versus toward the feet, so the belly button is inferior to the sternum. Right and left, we've got a right side of the body, left side, we are bilateral, there's a midline that'll break us into two sort of equivalent sides. Who's right and left? It is the patient, the thing you're looking at, it's their right and left. Lateral, medial, medial means toward the midline, lateral means away from it, so the elbow is lateral to the side of the wall here that I'm pointing at. So the nose is medial to the ear. Then, for the limbs only, you have proximal distal. This replaces superior inferior. Proximal distal only for structures in one limb, so the elbow is proximal to the wrist. Superficial deep. This often involves things surrounding other things or layers of a structure. So the heart is surrounded by the skin. The heart is deep to the skin. We have planes that can cut the body up into slices. There's the frontal plane that comes down and cuts the body up into a front and back, or anterior and posterior regions. There is the transverse plane that'll come in and cut the body into a superior portion and an inferior portion. And there is the median plane, which, if it's going through the midline, will be called the mid-sagittal plane. That gives you a right side of the structure and the left side of the structure. Again, if it goes through the midline, it is a mid-sagittal plane, and if it is off, and so it's not a balanced cut, then it's a parasagittal plane. Finally, CT scan, computerized tomography, uses x-rays shot from all kinds of different directions to give us a detailed view of inside the body without having to cut the person off. Up is amazing, but unfortunately it is x-rays. Thank you.